But look at that vein material. See that? Oh, isn't that nice? And you see way over there too. See that? Oh, and look at this. See the shear zoning? They call it slick and slides. Look at that. Isn't that pretty? And look at all this nice material in there. See that? Ooh, that's nice. Oh, I like that. Really nice. And see the vein material right here? Oh yeah, that's nice. Right up in here, you gotta be careful. A lot of the clays, you got limonites, you got hard quartz veins. See, there's a hard quartz vein up in there. They took most of that. See that huge stope here at the Virginia Dale mine? Oh, that's nice. Oh yeah, look at that. Look at that vein over there. You can see where they were chasing the heck out of this. Little stringers of quartz, see that? See all this clayous material? See the quartz in there? And then here, look at this. Oh, that's pretty looking stuff. Look at that. You got quartz, you got hematites in there, probably replacing magnetite. You got a little bit of sulfides in there, and you got free mill gold. Look at that, all the way up to the surface. And you can see where somebody's been high grading down in there. See that? Oh, that's nice. That's real nice. I wanna take samples of this stuff. Yeah, look at that. Crush it up later, see if there's any gold in it. When you sample a vein, remember, you sample from side to side. And sometimes even get the hanging wall and the foot wall just to see if there's any mineralization in it. So that's a classic example right there. And that vein looks like it's got a 80 degree dip to it. Oh, that's pretty. That's real pretty. And I know there's gold in it. You see the four cyanide tanks. One of them still got some crushed ore in it, washed it with cyanide. And then when they're done, they collect up the pregnated cyanide solution, which has gold in solution. And then they'd pump the rest of it out as tailings, which was worthless. It had nothing in it. But that's how you do it. You crush it up as fine as possible, soak it in a weak solution of sodium cyanide. The cyanide becomes pregnated with gold and silver. And then you either add zinc, or in today's world, you use activated carbon. Oh man, it's a beautiful day out here. I thought it was supposed to be windy today. Well, I got you alone up here on the hill. It's just you and me now. See that? I don't know if you can see that. See that nice green rock? Take a look inside. What do you see? That is some good looking schist. Looks like a mica schist. Anyway, see the green? That green is from what? Olivine. That's right. Sometimes you get some chloride in there too. And remember I told you about that. That's a really important part of the mix. And you can see where this was in the contact zone right here. See how nice and slick that is? Now another thing you're gonna see out here, especially over at the Virginia Dale mine, is in the vein structures where they've been oxidized and turned red. Of course, that's what they were mining. You always tell by looking at the millings. Is take a look on the outer edges of the contact zones. What you're going to see there is you're going to see, not only you're going to see fault gouge, but you're also going to see a grillic alteration. And that's where a lot of the feldspars have been turned to clay. And what do we have here? See that? Ooh, that's pretty, huh? That's a piece of float right there. And look, there's another one right there. See that? Ooh, isn't that pretty? Now that looks like you've got a lot of these square holes in it and pitting. A lot of times, see that one there too? You can see that? Ooh, that's pretty. Now a lot of times that can either be caused by hydrothermal alteration, but in this case, based on the manganese oxide that you see here, and I see all this rusty, it almost looks like limonite, I'd say that this had sulfides in it that oxidized out and left the manganese and the limonite behind, which is hematite iron oxides. See that? So the question is where did it come from? So it must be coming from up there somewhere. Remember I told you about breccia? Brecciated veins? Usually you find them in chimneys and pipes, volcanic areas that got gold inside the fine ground mass. All right, so we're gonna go over some stuff real quick, okay? The three basic deposits. And we're talking about lode mining now, primary deposits, not secondary. There's only really three that you need to worry about.
And the three is going to be a porphyry deposit, a mesothermal deposit, and an epithermal. And like I said, most everything falls under that category. The porphyry deposits are really important. You got the ones that I like are the iron oxide copper gold deposits. I really like those. And you'll see a lot of those in Arizona. And we got one out here. Actually, to be honest, it's a replacement deposit. It's referred to as a polymetallic replacement deposit. And yeah, that technically falls under the category of a porphyry deposit. And then next you got mesothermal, which is your greenstone, your shear zone hosted, your Archean greenstones, a lot of your metamorphic folding like you have in California. Those are deep seated veins. That's all going to fall under your mesothermal category. And then of course you all know your epithermals. A lot of that's going to be shallow and next to a heat source, usually volcanic in nature. You see them a lot in Nevada. You got what's called back arc basin assemblages. And of course you got to remember that you've got that huge magma chamber, and then you've got a spout coming off of it that creates a volcano. Well, what's happening is you've got fractures and fissures in the rock, and that starts to heat up surrounding waters that might circulate through there, meteoric waters. And what will happen is you'll have these hot springs bringing this water up. Now, gold isn't soluble in just plain old water. It has to, like I said, it has to be in something that will dissolve it, and that's usually a chlorine base, like a brine solution, really salty, nasty stuff, or a sulfur complex like you have a lot of these high sulfidation zones. In your epithermals, you're going to get a lot of these vents that come out around these volcanoes. Remember I told you the magic number, which is 1, 3, 7, and 21. Those are the miles that you need to look at when you're looking on a topo map from most of these volcanic cones and shields and things like that. That's where you're going to find a lot of this mineralization. And that's why I always tell people, if you're looking for epithermals, look for low sulfidation, you're gonna find your chunkier gold. And you gotta remember, when you're working with geology, that everything didn't happen at one time. I mean, some of this stuff happened 3.5 million years ago. I mean, I got a whole bunch of basement rock underneath me right now. That's from the Precambrian time period. And then I got all this tertiary volcanics around here that happened maybe 10,000 years ago, or maybe a little later. On top here, I've got a lot of this porphyry andesite, which is a volcanic, and then I got basement rocks underneath here of granitic gneiss, and I've also got some granite diorite down there too. Now here, I've got some nice copper staining. See that? I don't know if you can see it. And I got some manganese oxide. That's always great in the mix when you're looking for gold. Now, another thing you're gonna see when you're out looking for gold is when you start seeing quartz that has these big ugly red pitting in it. See that? And they call those bugs. Well, if you look carefully at this one, I'll see if I can get it in there close for you. Can you see that? All right, now, these bugs are square. All of them are square in nature. And what does that tell you? That's right. That means that there used to be what? Iron pyrite in there. And what has happened is it has oxidized out, leaving just the iron and hopefully native gold behind. And when you're out here in these gold producing districts, you're gonna see some of this quartz that's really vuggy, which means there's a lot of pitting in it, a lot of holes. Take a good look with your jeweler's loop. That's why you gotta bring one of these. Take a good look with your jeweler's loop and see if they're square. And that'll tell you that, yeah, that was pyrite that oxidized out, and hopefully it left the gold if there was any native gold behind. When you're looking at some of this quartz structures, and you notice there's a lot of pitting in it, and it looks like there's a whole bunch of little holes running all throughout it. That can be caused from what's called hydrothermal alteration. And all that means is that there was some type of hydrothermal fluids that have come in contact with it, and it has altered it. It has basically started to dissolve it, or it has impregnated it with minerals. Now, also you'll see, like I'm seeing out here, is that some of these holes aren't square. They're actually kind of weird shaped and round and oblong. What can happen is when this pyrite is exposed to water, what happens? What do you get from that? Sulfuric acid. The sulfuric acid will actually start to eat into the quartz. It'll start to dissolve away some of the silica, and it'll leave these really weird shaped bugs in there. But it's always a good sign when you see green staining, blacks and reds on quartz. Look at this huge outcropping right here. Look at that, isn't that pretty? Ooh, I could just take that whole thing home. And I got some bugs in there and some crystallization pockets. Nice pegmatites in there. Usually crystals are growing out of that.
I got some iron staining, I got some copper staining in here. Man, that's a big old one. Anyway, I wanted you to see this because it's very important, because I got some things to tell you about it. Whenever you find quartz veins like this, first of all, chances are there's another one somewhere in the area. You always have at least another vein somewhere. It's a parallel vein. And sometimes you have what's called swarms, where you have a whole bunch of little veins running throughout the area. Because think about it, when the rock fractured and busted open, it didn't just make one crack, it made a whole bunch of cracks. And they usually travel in the same direction, don't they? The mineral-rich solution comes flowing up through there. So people see one vein, they get excited. I say, no, there's probably another one, maybe a whole handful of them in the area. But they always run parallel because the way the rock fractures naturally. Now, another thing I gotta cover about these veins is people see these quartz veins and they get all excited. Well, a lot of times the stuff on top, if there's any mineralization, it's leached out millions of years ago. So people try to get up underneath it to see if there's any mineralization down deeper. And this one don't look like it's got anything in it. It might have, but I think it's leached out long ago, and that's why you got dry washers going up and down in these washes, because any gold that was here fractured off millions of years ago and is down in there. Now, another thing I got to cover real quick that you're not going to read about is anytime you find veins like this, look in the area to see if you got any veins that are running at a 45 or even a 90 from these. I have found a lot of really, really rich mineralized veins that are running at a 45 degree angle of these like this, or sometimes a 90 off to the side. And those will be the veins that are rich, not these. So that's something I wanted to cover, because you're not going to hear that anywhere else. I've got all these swarms going up the side of the hill, and people have been poking into them, trying to find something. But I bet you didn't find nothing, did you? Now, remember what I told you? That when you find one vein, there's usually more in the area. You just have to look. It's a parallel vein, and a lot of times you have swarms. And then, of course, if you got thousands of them, it's called stockworks. But anyway, look at this. I got that vein that I just chased, but look at this right here. It was right below the surface. See that? Look at that beautiful looking vein. Imagine how many people just walk right over the top of it. There must not be more than 6 inches of dirt sitting over the top of it. And I got tons and tons of magnetite. Ooh, that's a good sign. I won't go into it right now, but like I said, magnetite can form in a replacement deposit, and that's always a good sign. I got copper staining too. And I got magnetite all up and down the side of this vein. And the vein I was just looking at, it's about 20 feet away running up the side of the hill. And then there's another one that outcrops, and another one. Like I told you, there's parallel veins and there's swarms. You don't stop. It's like potato chips, son. You just can't have one. It's a horse, man, dude. It's a horse. Woo, see the malachite in there? Isn't that pretty? I got copper staining right there too. I don't know if you can see that. Anyway, you can see where it's on the outside of this vein. The vein probably goes through the hill and comes out on the other side. Ooh, but I gotta have lunch. I'm starving like Marvin. Okay, so anyway, you know what I'm gonna say, huh? Ah, so come on! Ah, let's go! Ooh, look at that thing. Ooh. Oh, man, that would hurt. I don't wanna fall down that. It's only like maybe 40 feet, but man, 40 feet will mess up your day. See that quartz vein running right in the middle? This is a good example of deposition. I wanted you to see that. You got some copper staining, and you got some weathering going on in there. You got some hematite, which is probably replacing the magnetite. And you can see how a lot of the feldspars on the outer wall, which is the hanging wall down there, changed. It's a really good illustration, and I wanted you to see that. And of course, they were hoping that the mineralization would get heavier, and of course the gold would get heavier on the way down, like I told you. But evidently it didn't, because they stopped 40 feet down. But that doesn't mean there's not some good specimens in there somewhere. But I just wanted you to see that. And there's this one, and there's three other ones that crest the top of this hill. And they run down the other side of the valley, and you can see where they've been digging there too. That's what I tell you. Make sure if you find one, check the area. It could only be inches under your feet, and you could be standing on the mother lode. I wanted you to see this, because a lot of people don't know it. But when you see quartz rock that has this really funky yellow, and sometimes it'll have a band of red around the outside, but when you see this really funky yellow, usually what that indicates, if you can see that, is what? That's right, sulfides. That's the sulfur that's oxidizing off of that sulfide. See that? And if you look right in the middle, you can see what? That's right, sulfides. So what I'd like to do is crush him up and see if there's anything in it. But I just wanted you to see that. If you see any of this funky yellow in the rock, that means that there's a sulfide somewhere in there, and that's the sulfur coming out of it. That's why it gives it that weird color. And when you break it open and sniff it, you'll smell the sulfur. So I know I said it before, but I really gotta go now. So come on, let's go. Hold on to my hat.